Prince William and Duchess Kate get ready for Halloween as they set out to hire a new housekeeper, as Harry and Meghan launch their new foundation, Archwell, and Harry gets candid about racism.
No one's pointing the fingers. It's been, you can't really point the fingers, especially when it comes to unconscious bias, but once you realize or you feel a little bit uncomfortable, then the onus is on you to go out and educate yourself as much, because ignorance is no longer an excuse.
More details emerge about season 4 of The Crown as Emma Corrin transforms into Princess Diana.
Oh yeah, I really enjoyed it. It was the best day of my life. Best day of my life. And it kind of sounds very, very sweet and very, very sincere.
Plus, author Ingrid Seward reveals all about Prince Philip in her new book, Prince Philip Revealed.
You know, take a stand. You either say that it is not going to work, or you marry her. Mm-hmm. And Charles, you know, being sort of probably, you know, he was frightened of his father. And he probably thought, well, okay, I'll marry her if that's what you want me to do.
We've got that plus so much more in today's Royally Us. Hello to our fellow royal lovers, and welcome to Royally Us. I'm Christina, that's Molly, the host of the Diva Behavior Podcast. Hi, Molly.
Hi, Christina. How are you doing?
Good. How about you?
Pretty good.
We have a lot to get to today. We were actually just saying there's not a ton of royal news to get to, but we do have a fabulous interview with Ingrid, who talked so much about Prince Philip's life. I think you guys are really, really going to enjoy it. Everything from his relationship with Prince Charles to Princess Diana and what he thinks of Harry and Meghan.
Yeah, it was so interesting. And I mean, Prince Philip is someone that I don't really think about that often. And I always learn something new whenever I, you know, think about him, I guess.
Definitely. Yeah, no, I'm excited for you guys to see this. But before we get to that, we have to talk about our royal viewers, our royal watchers, who, like always, have a lot to say. Let's kick it off with J. Renee Thompson, who says, why should a person endorse someone mistreating them? That's like saying the person who is doing the bullying is correct. That's the problem with racism. The racist person always believes they are right, and that is so wrong. Of course, talking about Meghan saying that she is the most trolled person in the world, and, talking a lot about how she's been bullied online.
Yeah, I think this also came last week, correct me if I'm wrong, from someone who had said, why can't she be more like Camilla and right. just deal with it? And yeah, I agree with this commenter because, yeah. I don't know if there's ever a good way to deal with being mistreated other than trying to get the mistreatment to stop, I guess.
Yeah. Definitely. All right, the next one is from Allison, says, perhaps Her Majesty didn't wear a mask to show off her rocking pink lipstick. Such a stylish 94-year-old wearing bright outfits and stepping out, walking without aid or even a cane. She even still drives herself, right? I wonder if she still rides as she loves horses. Very fit. I mean, we do have to agree that she, for 94 years old, she is rocking it.
Yeah, she is rocking it, but I mean, masks are still a pretty good idea.
Yeah, masks no are matter. A good idea, and you can make them fashionable.
Yeah, and you don't have to wear lipstick if you have a mask on.
That so is very true. Very, very true. All right, well, it is time for our royal roundup, our royal news of the week, and we have to kick it off. I love this story because Kate and William are looking to fill a role as a permanent housekeeper at Kensington Palace. So if you're in the area, if you have some housekeeping experience, make sure to apply.
Yeah, they said the starting salary is a little over £19,000, which is about $25,000, which I thought it would be a little higher.
I thought it would be a little bit higher too, because it seems like a pretty demanding job. Like, you have to do a lot.
Yeah, it is live-in, so I guess you don't really have to pay rent, but you're sort of giving your whole life over to this job. And the other thing that surprised me about it was that this person is working in aid of the senior housekeeper. So it's like, wow, how many housekeepers do they have?
How many housekeepers do you need? I guess when you have a place that is that big, you do need quite a few. Is there a requirement for those who want to apply?
The requirement is just being able to manage a varied workload, show initiative, be flexible, and be discreet. That was one of the things that jumped out, because most employers don't really ask you to necessarily be discreet. But yeah, I guess they want someone who's not going to go running to the press and telling all their stories.
That is true. I mean, if you come to think about it, how many people they probably employ and how many people have spoken out about working for the family, it's very, very few and far between. There really isn't that many. And I imagine that the people that do speak to the press, they have been given permission.
Yeah, there was just that one notorious time when the Queen and Princess Margaret's nanny, Marion Crawford, wrote a whole book about them, and they never spoke to her again. They like excommunicated her from all the royal fold. So I guess anybody who does work for the royal family, it's just a question of whether you want a bestseller or to be friends with the royals. So yes. I guess they're always looking for someone who's not so much of a writer.
Yeah. Oh God. What a job that would be. Definitely. Well, Prince William, in the midst of finding a new housekeeper, he also took some time this week to help lay the foundation stone at the country's largest cancer hospital. Take a look at this.
I'm personally delighted to be with you all today to lay the foundation stone of the Oak Centre, 30 years after my mother did the very same thing at the Royal Marsden in Chelsea, commemorating the building of the Chelsea Wing.
You know, this is a great way for him to give back, and it also kind of ties back into his mom, Princess Diana, which he just spoke about.
Yeah, it's really nice. So 30 years ago, Diana laid a ceremonial foundation stone at the Chelsea wing of the Royal Marsden in London. Mm-hmm. And now William's doing the same thing at this Royal Marsden, which is outside London. So he's just really like taking the initiative to kind of keep going and doing what she used to do.
Yeah, he's definitely following in his mom's footsteps and kind of, you know, doing the same path that she did, which I think is fantastic.
Yeah.
And it looked very rainy there. It did not look like a nice day, but he still made the most of it.
Yeah, the British weather is back to being very British.
Yes. All right. Well, finally, we heard from Harry and Meghan. We've been talking about this foundation, R12, for months and months and months, and they finally launched their new website. And we got a little bit more information about it.
Yeah, so this is their third charitable foundation as a couple, because first Meghan joined William, Kate, and Harry in the Royal Foundation. Then Meghan and Harry split off for Sussex Royal. That only lasted a few months, and now we have Archwell, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, now we have, yes, there's so many moving parts to this, but we did learn a little bit more about the foundation. They did say, you know, they gave the meaning of Archie's name and why they wanted to do this, and it seems like, you know, this is the first step in their next chapter of their lives together.
Yeah, and the design of the website is really simplistic and really nice. I think it definitely sends a message of like, we're here just for business and not so much for like the royal flourish. So yeah, that was really interesting to see.
Yeah, I did sign up for the newsletter. I haven't gotten any more emails about it, so we'll have to keep you guys posted. But yeah, like we said, it's the next step, so we'll see what happens. But definitely exciting news for Harry and Meghan. And also Prince Harry has been speaking out a lot about racism in the last few months, and he did it again with British GQ about coming to terms with racial bias after seeing it through his own wife, Meghan. Take a look at this.
Unconscious bias, from my understanding, you know, having had the upbringing and the education that I had, I had no idea I had no idea it existed. And then, you know, sad as it is to say, it took me many, many years to realize it, especially then living a day or a week in my wife's shoes.
So yeah, like we said, Harry's been kind of talking about this a lot. Obviously, it's been a topic that we've been talking about for months, but he's definitely seeing things in a new perspective since being married to Meghan.
Yeah, and he said that before he walked a day in Meghan's shoes, he had no idea that unconscious bias really existed. And I thought that was really brave to admit, because you know, a lot of people are going to be looking at everything he says and going through it with a fine-tooth comb. And it's great that he's being honest about his starting point and the work that he's doing now.
Yeah, definitely. And like we said, he's been talking about it for months. Who knows, this might be part of the charity foundation, maybe that they're going to be kind of tying racism into that and ways that they can give back and kind of raise questions and education about this, because it seems like it's something that both of them are very passionate about.
Yeah, and they can do so much good with it too.
They really can. They really can. Well, if you send Princess Beatrice a congratulations to her wedding, you better check your mailbox, because she is sending very sweet personalized notes to her well-wishers, which I love this. I think this is great.
Yeah, it's really nice. The note is really cute. Her handwriting was really interesting to me.
Yes.
It was nice, very legible.
Uh-huh.
Great. And yeah, it must be really exciting to get royal mail in your mail.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, a royal fan kind of uploaded the note that she sent. And yeah, so if you sent her something, you very well may get a note back. So that is a nice little personalized touch, which I like.
Yes. Very thoughtful.
Yes, totally. All right. Well, now it is time to spill the royal tea. And we have a lot of information coming up on season 4 of The Crown. But before we get to all of that, we have to talk about Meghan's good friend, Jessica Mulrooney, who had some eyebrows raised when she posted a photo of her and her husband kissing. But it was the caption that got a lot of people's attention, right?
Right. This was a curveball, I would say. So yeah. The caption said, after a few rough months, something to finally celebrate. Thank you for being by my side. Thank you to our true friends for sticking by us. We could have never made it without you. And that's not even the shadiest part, because then she goes on to say, silver lining, we finally know the curse word who we thought were our friends. Best gift we could have ever been given. Pardon my manners.
Yikes. So I wonder who she is talking about. We have had some reporting going back and forth about whether or not Meghan and Jessica are still friends after Jessica found herself in this social media feud with influencer Sasha Exeter, and Jessica kind of brought Meghan into the fold. It's very complicated and a lot of different layers to that story, but ever since then, we've heard that their relationship is strained. We're not exactly 100% sure.
Yeah, this definitely seems like the hard times for the Mulroonies didn't end with that Instagram saga. Mm-hmm. It seems like they've been feeling repercussions from that for a few months based on this Instagram caption. So yeah, it's hard to tell exactly what's the status of their friendship with Meghan, but I don't know. I mean, I don't know if the royals are usually friends with people who curse on Instagram.
Yeah, I don't think so. I mean, we haven't seen them together at all. I mean, even though, you know, Meghan is stateside, obviously we're under a pandemic, so it's not so easy to kind of get together with friends, but we really have not seen them together at all. I mean, Meghan and Harry have been out on double dates with other couples and things like that, so they have been out and about, but no sign of her with Jessica.
Yeah, this is definitely a story I'm going to keep an eye on because it's for some reason really interesting to me. I don't know why.
Me too. Well, I know something that is interesting to us both is season 4 of The Crown. It is right around the corner. It premieres next month. And everybody is talking about how Emma Corrin kind of transformed into Princess Diana. So take a look at this.
They hadn't even started filming season 3, let alone thinking about season 4. So that was taken at this place. They were doing pickups for season 3. We were in a very stately home. We read the scene through, and then Ben, the director, turned to Suzanne, one of the producers, and said, can I tell her now? Can I tell her? And Suzanne was like, let's maybe read it through once more. And I was like, oh God, okay. And so then we read it through once more. Yeah, and then Ben was like, can I do it now? And Suzanne was like, do it now. And then he was kind of like, we need to be our Diana. But it was so intense.
She definitely sounds like her.
Yes, it's amazing. And I love the repartee that the three actors have together. You would never know that they were playing people who were in this, you know, gigantic three-way feud together for years.
You're right. That's so true. This season obviously explores everything that's going on with Diana and Charles and talks a lot about Diana before we even knew her with Charles. So kind of a little bit more of her backstory, which I think is going to be interesting for a lot of people to see as well. Obviously the big affair, the three-way love triangle, and a little bit of the wedding, not the whole thing though.
Right, just a little, which is an interesting choice, don't you think? I guess they figure that everyone has seen the footage of the real wedding, so there's no need to reproduce it, but it is great that we're going to see the wedding dress. They reproduced the dress.
I'm like anxious to see how they're going to recreate, you know, Diana walking down the aisle and then seeing Camilla in the crowd, because she has talked about that and how that like totally threw her off during her wedding, which may be why she flubbed the lines when she was saying Charles's name during their vows.
Can you imagine? What is with the royals and inviting their exes to their weddings? They all do it.
They really do. It's so bizarre. It's like, we get it. If you're on good terms, that's great. But I would never invite my ex to my wedding.
I don't even follow mine on Instagram.
No. Right. Out of sight, out of mind. Yeah. But producers did come out and say that they are never going to be covering Meghan and Harry. They're never really going to be covering present day royals.
Right. They're going to stop around 2002. That's what the speculation is around the Tony Blair era. Which is post Diana's death, obviously. And it's gonna, they think it's gonna end the year that Princess Margaret and the Queen Mother died within a month of each other. That's like everybody's educated guess, although the producers haven't revealed exactly what it's gonna be. So yeah, I find it interesting that they are extending that deal. I was wondering if maybe it had to do with the fact that Meghan and Harry are in the Netflix fold now. So they feel like they sort of have the seal of approval. Right. I don't know.
Yeah, no, that's a really good point. I mean, maybe that could have been part of the contract being like, you can't cover us on the Crown if you want us to be part of your franchise, I guess.
Yeah, and I think we're too close to it to cover it on the Crown. Right. It's gotta be some time elapsed.
Yeah, I think so too. I totally agree with you. Well, I cannot wait. I'm counting down the days till season 4. It's gonna be fantastic.
It is. I'm gonna have to try really hard not to binge it.
I know. Totally. All right, well, now it is time to break down the royal rules, and to help us do that is author Ingrid Seward, who has released a brand new book all about the life of Prince Philip called Prince Philip Revealed. Now, we recently caught up with her and to talk about Philip as a father, his thoughts on Harry and Meghan, and his complicated relationship with Princess Diana. Take a look. Congratulations on the book. Like I said, I absolutely loved it. It was a fabulous read. So what made you want to write this book about Philip?
Well, I've always been interested in Philip, and he seems a bit of an enigma. And one heard bits about him, but not a great deal about him. And I just knew that he'd always been there in the background. He likes to stay in the background.
So you talk a lot in the book about the relationship between Prince Philip and Prince Charles. And of course, with the Crown and everything, this is something that's become very relevant to the public's interest too. Do you know what the status of their relationship is right now?
Well, right now, I mean, he's 99 years old. Prince Charles is about to reach his 72nd birthday, I think. So of course they get on well now, because Charles is the heir to the throne. He's attentive to his grandfather when he sees him, which of course at the present time isn't very often. And I think in a way Prince Philip is proud of his son, Prince Charles, in a way that he wasn't before. And he sees that all the things that he taught Prince Charles, like about the environment and about the planet, and you know what we're doing to the planet, which is very current in this country right now, he taught Prince Charles, who in turn taught Prince William, who in turn is teaching Prince George. So that is Philip's legacy, that he was the first royal to ever speak out about the climate and the potential dangers.
Mm-hmm. So why did Diana, you wrote that she turned to Philip in the beginning of her marriage when she was having issues instead of maybe Charles. And how, can you tell us a little bit about that? How did that work out?
Well, what happened was when Diana married into the family, you know, Prince Philip looked after her because he looks after all the girls, including Meghan, when she first came into the family, because he knows what it's like to be the new boy on the block or the new girl on the block and suddenly come into this, you know, this family with all their strange protocols and everything else. And Philip, being a, you know, a very intelligent man, he knew how to handle all these newcomers. But in return, he expected loyalty, and he expected that they too would have a sense of duty like he had. Right. And as far as Diana was concerned, he wanted to help because he felt that Charles wasn't helping in the marriage. And he thought, someone's got to do something. The Queen wasn't doing anything. He used to say, Lily, but you cannot sit on the fence over this. Someone has to do something. So I think he decided that in the lack of anything else happening, he would write to Diana. And Diana was very grateful to him, because basically she didn't have to, you know, face seeing him that way when things were really, really wrong. She could just deal with it in letters. Mm-hmm. And he was helpful. And he said things like, you know, Diana, you must remember that this monarchy is not a popularity contest. It's all of us working together, which is probably something he could have said to Meghan, to try and make these newcomers understand it's not all about me. It's about the institute of the monarchy as a whole. And Diana was very happy with the letters, and then it just ran out of steam, and then she decided that she hated Prince Philip more than anyone else in the world.
Yeah. I mean, why did she end up hating him more than anybody? I mean, because like you said, he was there for her. They had these very cordial and she seemed very grateful for those letters, but then everything kind of shifted. Maybe when the Andrew Norton book came out, that kind of maybe is where things kind of fell off a little bit, right?
Well, I think Prince Philip felt that Diana was harming the monarchy, and he became angry. And then his letters changed, you know, from being, you know, nice and helpful to being quite edgy and nasty. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and Diana it was one of those very insecure people that literally hates being told off and can't deal with it in any manner at all. So she just blocked him. And, you know, decided that she hated him. And she told me that she told William and Harry, never ever shout at people like your grandfather does. You know, I never ever want to hear you doing that and behaving in that way. Mm. And then later she said that she thought Prince Philip was an amusing dinner party guest, but she would never turn to him for advice. So there is Diana B. Contrary all the way down the line. And I think this is one of the reasons we're so fascinated by Diana still, because she says one thing to one person and one thing to another.
And then it's that Charles almost blamed Philip for the marriage to Diana, right?
Yes, he did. He felt he'd been very pushed into marrying Diana. This is in retrospect, of course. Actually, no, I think you're right. I think it was at the time, because he told some of his friends that he felt pressurized into marrying Diana because Philip said, you know, you've either got to marry her or let her go. You can't string a girl like, you know, a young girl, she's only 19, you can't string her along. And all the press are saying, oh, this is going to be, you know, the next queen. And then dump her. You've got to, you know, take a stand. You either say that it is not going to work or you marry her. Mm-hmm. And Charles, you know, being sort of probably, you know, he was frightened of his father. And he probably thought, well, okay, I'll marry her if that's what you want me to do.
So how does Philip feel about Meghan?
I thought you'd ask me that. he was very welcoming to Meghan because, of course, she was a newcomer and you know, a very different newcomer. But, of course, at the time of Meghan and Harry's romance, Philip wasn't round nearly as much because he'd retired. So he didn't see very much of Meghan at all. So he didn't really have a chance to form a relationship with her. He was determined that he was going to, you know, go to the wedding because he'd literally just had a hip operation 6 weeks before, which is, you know, a really good example of him being absolutely determined that whatever happened, he was going to walk down that aisle in the wedding and take his seat. Mm-hmm. And he was not going to have a stick and he was not going to have a wheelchair. But he didn't go to the reception afterwards. Obviously, that you know, that whole marriage ceremony and the long sermon and everything else was pretty uncomfortable, but he'd never let it show. So I would say that he had very high hopes for Meghan. And then I think he would have been very, very disappointed at how it panned out.
Yeah. I mean, Philip is always, you know, by the royal book. So this had to be a huge disappointment, especially knowing how much Harry loved his military life too, and he had to strip that, you know, he's no longer has the military title. So, I mean, do we know what their relationship is like right now? Did he try to stop Harry from doing this, or was he a little bit more hands off?
No, he was much more hands off. Mm-hmm. I think he can't, his feeling is he can't understand why, what was so awful about being a member of the royal family. You know, they had a beautiful house. They had a huge influence, and Harry was really enjoying helping the military, and Meghan had, you know, got a place for herself, you know, the beginnings of a place for herself in the Commonwealth. And it was all, and then they had a beautiful child. So beautiful house, beautiful child, you know, looked after. What was so awful about that? I don't think Philip can understand Harry, what he calls Harry's dereliction of duty. How Harry could say, I don't want to be a prince, I'm going. He just couldn't fathom it and can't fathom it.
Mm-hmm. Wow. One of the most reported quotes of Philip's of the last couple years was him allegedly saying, we step out with actresses, we don't marry them. Is there any truth to that? Did he really say that, in your opinion?
I don't think he's, it just doesn't sound like him. I mean, Philip loved actresses. And I just think it's a kind of remark he wouldn't make. It just doesn't sound like him. He's not, in these throwaway remarks, I mean, he might have said it as a joke, but he would have known, you know, he would have known it wouldn't be taken as a joke. So I don't, you know, unless I actually heard him say that himself, I find it really hard to believe. I think it's just, it's apocryphal. I think it's just sounds like something Philip might say. But to me, knowing him the way I do, it sounds exactly like the sort of thing Philip wouldn't say, because, you know, he understands, you know, he loves gorgeous women. So why would he say that, you know, actresses are not for marrying? I don't think he would.
Thank you so, so much for taking so much time and speaking with us all about it. It is so fascinating. It is such a great read, and I can't wait for everybody to get their hands on it.
Well, you're very kind. Thank you so much, too.
Yeah, this is such a really, like you said, you don't really know too much about Prince Philip, and I think this really takes a really nice deep dive into his life and his complex relationships with pretty much everybody.
Yeah, it's also interesting to see the way that he has taken on the role of a royal spouse.
Yeah.
When, you know, you think of it as a role that doesn't have much power, but it actually has a huge effect mm-hmm. on the way that the royal family is run. So
yeah.
It's cool to see him sort of the way that he's dealt with that.
Definitely. Yeah. How he kind of, you know, transitioned into that too, because in the beginning, I mean, he wasn't ready for it. No, but they both weren't ready for it when King George died so young. And they were kind of thrust into this spotlight. So it's a really good read. So if you have a chance, pick it up. All right, well, let's move on to our royal history moment of the week. And I absolutely love this story because now most of us hate the thought of daylight savings times, but imagine having to turn back 1500 clocks in the palace. I couldn't do that.
Yeah, it's so crazy. I would never think about this, mm-hmm. but yeah, every year a group of horological conservators, which is people that work with clocks and yes. preserve old clocks, head to the royal palaces and they adjust 1500 clocks for daylight savings time. So there's 450 at Windsor, 600 at Buckingham Palace, and 50 at Holyrood House. So that seems like the most monotonous job ever. Yes. But
hopefully they don't miss one if you have like yeah. a checklist.
Yeah. And I guess it's a dream job for someone who's like a clock aficionado.
Oh, totally. Yeah. It's a pretty cool job seeing all those old clocks. I mean, I'm sure they have, they have 1500 of them. So I'm sure that it's yeah. a lot of fun. All right. Before we wrap up, we have to check in on our royal kids out in our pint-sized palace. And of course, Halloween is right around the corner and the royal kids will be celebrating, right?
Yes, so the royal kids are going to be carving pumpkins. Mm-hmm. And something interesting that I learned in the process of researching this story is that British people don't say jack-o'-lantern.
Oh, interesting.
They just say pumpkin faces or carved pumpkins.
That's so funny.
Yeah, really interesting trivia, right?
Fun fact of the day. I love that.
And yeah, it really kind of highlights how weird of a word jack-o'-lantern is, but
it is weird. It is. I wonder like where that came from.
Apparently, I looked this up too. Apparently, it was an Irish myth. So if people want to Google that and have a really fun tidbit to bore people at parties, feel free. But yeah, so they're going to be carving pumpkins. In previous years, they have dressed up and trick-or-treated apparently around Kensington Palace, but it seems that this year either they're not doing that or they're not really publicizing the fact that they're doing that.
Right, yeah, obviously under the circumstances, I think Halloween is going to look a lot different for many, many people this year.
Yeah, definitely.
But I'm sure they'll still make it a lot of fun for them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Molly, thank you so much for running down all things royals with me.
Thank you for having me.
Of course. We'll make sure to check out Royally Us every Wednesday at 10:30 on Us Weekly's YouTube channel. Keep commenting, keep subscribing, and we will see you next week.